Hey there, GBT community. Thank you again for joining us for Coalesce. My name's Kyle, and I'm the head of training over at DBT Labs. And I'm really excited to host this session where we're going to talk a lot about testing. And so the title of this session is How DBT Enables Systems Engineering in Analytics. And I'll be joined by Jorge, Cruz, Serralles. And all chat conversation is taking place in Coalesce DBT Systems Engineering and DBT Slack. If you're not in DBT Slack, be sure to go to community.getdbt.com and then look for the channel Coalesce DBT Systems Engineering. And when you enter that space, we encourage you to connect with other attendees, ask questions, make comments, of course, share memes, all the things. And after the session, we'll be available to answer questions in the Slack channel. So feel free to queue them up and our chat champion will pin them so that we can raise those towards the end in the live session right now, if we have time. And so let's get started. Jorge, over to you.
All right. Thank you, Kyle. All right. Hey, everyone. I am Jorge Cruz Serralles, and thank you for coming to my talk on how DBT enables systems engineering and analytics. Before I start, I would like to thank Erica Louis of DBT Labs for her mentorship and guidance in this process. I'd also like to thank Chris Byington, Flavin Basad, and the rest of the data team at Updater for everything it taught me about how to think about data. Now, about me. I was born and raised in San Juan, Puerto Rico. After that, I went to Georgia Tech for my bachelor's degree and studied industrial and systems engineering. While in college, I interned in data roles for Delta. A lot of the analogies that I use in this talk are inspired by my experiences at Delta. Currently, I'm a data analyst for Updater's data team. You might ask, what's Updater? Updater is a company that offers different B2C and B2B solutions that make completing moving-related tasks seamless. In other words, we're in the moving space. Currently, we have a double-digit market share of US moves every year. On our platform, we have more than 8,000 properties, about 2 million housing units, and over 100,000 brokerage agents. To keep up with this growth, and so right now, we're currently at about 200 employees after having doubled in 2021. And we expect to double again to 400 in 2022. My team, the data team, has gone from 6 to 15 employees this year. Speaking very abstractly, the data team's reason of being is to improve business outcomes by using data. We do this through data democratization, which entails arming everyone at the company with the education, the guidance, and the tools that they need to extract insights from this data. We also do this through driving company strategy, which, for example, could be done by developing new data products or by analyzing user behavior in order to drive product recommendations. Most importantly is building and maintaining the data platform, which consolidates all of our business data and insights to facilitate data analysis and exchange. Right here, you have a diagram of what our data platform looks like. On the left, you have a series of data inputs, which are captured using Fitran and Kinesis, which are then transformed and loaded into Snowflake using DBT in order to be used in different data products. And so coming from a systems engineering background myself, I saw this diagram and was like, wow, this is a lot like a piece of physical infrastructure, a lot like an airplane. And so speaking of airplanes, let me ask you a question. Would you want to fly a plane that hasn't been thoroughly tested? I think the answer is no. You would definitely not, because it could simply fall out of the sky. Likewise, people won't want to use a data product that hasn't been tested thoroughly either. It's like with flying. It's all or nothing. And so when people run into issues with a data product, it can have negative consequences. It can lower people's trust in your data platform. It can lead to lower usage of it. People may begin to revert to obsolete tools. And so how do we stop this from happening? How do we prevent our plane from falling out of the sky? The solution is systems engineering, which is a general framework I will explain and discuss in this talk. Specifically, we'll go over what systems engineering is, a general framework for it, how it's imperative in building and maintaining a large project, how to think about testing, how to approach testing at scale, and how to reduce the human impact of said monitoring. What is systems engineering? It's basically an engineering field, not more of a mindset really, that's focused on designing, integrating, managing, and iterating over complex systems. This right here is a Venn diagram common to systems engineering. On the left, you have your design elements, what you want your device to do, what its general requirements are, how its different components work together, and how they're linked. On the right, you have the steps that map onto things like, say, validating that your airplane's wheels are correctly, that the wiring is working correctly, and that in the end, your airplane and the people in it can get safely from A to B. Does this sound familiar? This is what the waterfall model in software development is based off of. When you're building a DBT project, you are using the same thought process that you would when you're building a physical system. As I just said, building a DBT project is like building an airplane. At first, your environment starts out like a paper airplane. It is manageable, lean, and easy to follow. It's the aerospace equivalent of a simple DBT project. Right here, we have a simple DBT project. This right here is the data engineering equivalent of a paper airplane. It is the minimum viable product that runs well, is easy to build, but is limited in functionality. Systems thinking may not seem as important when your data environment looks like this. You can get away with not having many tests because there are fewer repercussions if things break, and it's easy to fix. However, over time, things can get in the way between you and your DBT project. As tech debt accumulates, your business grows and priorities change, the innards of your airplane can begin to look like this, as will your data environment. As the saying goes, complex systems build complex systems. And as our systems become increasingly complex, our errors and bugs likewise become more complex. And so, how do we go from paper airplane to jumbo jet? To go from paper airplane to jumbo jet, we must continuously test and validate that our components and subcomponents are performing as intended. DBT is what enables us to do that at scale. To give more context, we would sometimes find ourselves catching different miscellaneous errors, such as broken integrations or seal credentials or broken workflows impacting user experience. It would often take us a couple of days to manually catch these errors. By then, the damage had been done. Whenever this happened, we would, of course, try to find a way to prevent these issues from happening again. That being said, one of our focuses has been to make catching these errors faster and easier. DBT has enabled us to do that by making it easier to test our components. DBT macros make it very easy to create generic, repeatable unit tests that you can use over and over. At Updater, we had a problem of missing or misfiring events. And so what we did is we built a macro that takes a table name, a column name, a date offset, and a count threshold, which you can see on the left. And so, for example, on the right, all three of these tests are set to error if less than 2,000 records are generated within our repository. We use this single generic test more than 30 times across tables that are updated on a daily basis. Now that we've built these tests, how do we scale them? Before DBT, before we implemented DBT at Updater, we had no testing. We simply had Airflow executing very large SQL files, sometimes 900 to 1000 lines. And in our previous state, as we migrated to DBT, what we did is we basically split up these very large SQL statements into separate models. We had one DAG per function. So for example, a TV related DAG, or an insurance related DAG, or a move related DAG, et cetera. And this previous state is when we first introduced testing. In our current state, we basically shifted from having a DAG per function to a DAG per schedule. And so let me tell you how you can use a game of tag to scale your testing. So we basically, we built tooling that made it possible for our job orchestrator, Airflow, to automatically schedule and execute a new DBT model and its associated tests and atomize retriable tasks by simply tagging a model with the appropriate schedule. This allows us to schedule tests, model runs, and other tasks without ever having to touch Airflow code directly. Because things are automatically scheduled, they're more reliable. And so in the screenshot, you can see some of our different data models and the different schedules that they're tagged. Here we can see the standard schedule, which is just a regular daily schedule, an hourly schedule, which is an hourly schedule, and a late schedule, which is basically the same thing as the standard schedule, but it just runs at 3 a.m. UTC. And so this is what one of our new schedule DAGs looks like on Airflow. We actually have custom operators that enable Airflow to interact with other applications more easily. Here you can see the two custom operators that we have defined, DBT run operator and DBT test operator. Once you have enough of these tests in place, managing them can begin to get quite difficult. At Updater, we made a Slack bot running on a Flask app that allows us to basically interact directly with our failed test alerts from within Slack, allowing us to see when the test ran, what its compiled SQL was, and even allowing us to snooze the test if need be. This has made it so much easier for us to run and validate our failed tests. Personally, I think snoozing is a super useful feature in that it lets you deprioritize noisy tests. And so it's a really low effort way of being able to ignore something or being able to ignore an alert for a couple of days without having to edit code directly. We've also leverage the same Slack bot to create alerts for freshness tests. And so from within a repository, now that we've implemented this, it's as easy as adding these warrant after or error after blocks in your sources file. And so once you have that set, we're able to receive Slack notifications that alert us of when a data source has gone stale. And so this makes it much easier to know when a data source has gone stale or broken in some form. And so something that I think is worth noting is that my team uses emojis on these alerts. We use the eyes emoji to denote that someone is looking into the alert. A green check mark, like the one that you can see in the screenshot, basically means that someone has looked into the alert and wrapped up their investigation. The main takeaway that I would love for all of you to leave this presentation with is to think of your DBT project as a jumbo jet. If anything fails, it could negatively impact a lot of people. Thank you. This is the end. Thank you so much for listening. Here's my contact info, and I'm now saving the rest of the time here for any questions. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, Jorge. I really appreciated the showing off actual code that you all use in production, particularly that custom generic test. It's really cool to see that. We've got a few questions I've queued up. I'll drop them in our private chat too. From a business perspective, how do you justify, especially with execs or business leads, the cost, be it in dev hours, new hires, or SaaS, of developing such a test system? Seems like you could spend a lot of time on testing. How do you justify that? And more often than not, especially at smallish companies, this type of extremely necessary endeavor will be put on the back burner or sent to the backlog where data tasks go to die. What do you think in terms of justifying all the testing that you've implemented? Did you have to get buy-in for that?
No, not really. The way I think about it is, it's if you work in an oil company or you work in an airline, it's something that you absolutely need to do. If you're developing a product that tens or hundreds of people or even thousands of people are touching every day, it's an absolute necessity to be able to conclusively say that all of your data is correct, that all of your data is passing tests, and that everything that you're showing is a source of truth.
Excellent. How do you, on a implementation level, how do you make sure your team is doing that? Is there like checkpoints using a pull request process? How do you make sure you do have testing moving forward? Are you muted, Jorge?
Sorry about that. Thank you. Yeah. So my team, yeah, it's basically standard pull request process. What we've done in order to clamp down and tighten on a lot of these tests is we've implemented a lot of different CircleCI tests in order to basically force the developer to include some of those.
Oh, excellent. So you're testing on pull requests also before you merge that code in. Beautiful. Yeah. And similar, so you mentioned the emoji reactions. We use those internally here at DBT Labs. Eyes, I'm looking at this, check, this has been addressed. I'm not sure how large your team is, but how do you, once you get that notification, what does your triage process look like? You're monitoring, how do you make sure that gets covered at the right time with your team?
Yeah, so over at Updater, we have a team of roughly 12 to 15 people now. And so we have people spread out over multiple different time zones. We have people in the East Coast, in Central, Mountain, and Pacific. The way that we've usually split it out so far is usually whichever person is most closely tied to that model or to that data source that erred or notified during that time. If they're online, then they touch it or basically check on it. Otherwise, if it's urgent, somebody else will check up on it. If it's not a super urgent alert, we might wait until the next morning for someone who's more familiar with it to check up on it.
Excellent. Great. That makes sense. Go to the person who wrote the code for it. You hinted at, going back to your presentation, you hinted at migrating a bunch of SQL files from your previous state, pre-DBT. Could you tell us more about that process? How did you tackle that? Because I imagine a lot of people are moving from a previous system into DBT.
Yeah, I came in right after most of that work was done. So not the most tied to it or experienced with it. But yeah, it's all about being able to take these bigger models and breaking them down into, more usable units of code. For example, one heuristic that we stick to is we try to make all of our models at most maybe 100, 120 lines of code. And just to start, I think that's a pretty good, baseline. If you have a model and it's 600 lines of code, it should probably be split up into 3 or 4.
Yeah, totally. And then I'm curious, do you use ephemeral models at all or different materializations on that front? We're getting a little away from testing.
I don't, but other people might do.
A new fresh question in from Jacob. And it is DBT the best tool for testing data? What is done when a few rows of data fail validation? Does the whole pipeline stop?
Yeah, I do think DBT is the best tool out there for testing data. Yeah, so for example, let's say you're running a data pipeline with 5 models all stacked on top of each other. If the most upstream model fails, if that most model is running and the test attached to it fails, because these tests are attached to the model and just run right after the model, as soon as that first model fails, that test associated with that first model fails, that something's wrong in your data pipeline. It doesn't stop. If you have something like a Slack alerting system attached to this, then as soon as that first test that fails associated with that model fails, you'll be notified immediately. And so the pipeline will continue running, but you'll know as soon as that first model and that first series of tests associated with it are done running that something's wrong.
Yeah, definitely. Something to point out for folks that might be new to DBT, it is slightly different from unit testing. Like, it's build my data sets or my models, and then you test on top of it. So if you're coming from a software engineering perspective, just a little bit different. And another question that came to mind for you, Jorge, is you're testing sources with source freshness. You're testing models. Are you doing anything to test it like the BI layer downstream from DBT? Curious if you've explored that at all.
Yeah. So it's interesting that you asked that. We have been looking into doing that. We haven't implemented anything directly on the DBT layer, but so our BI layer is Looker. And so we've begun implementing a lot of different cleanups and changes to how we work with Looker in order to tighten down on that. We are looking into using spectacles, I believe, to clamp down tighter on data quality.
Awesome. Yeah, I know Dylan Baker. I've taught a few courses with him. Cool stuff happened over there at Spectacles. Anything else you'd like to just tell folks about how to get started with testing, like a final, why is it so important? Close out with some wisdom from you.
Yeah, I guess my biggest piece of advice if you're a beginner is documentation on DBT Labs website is incredible. Very easy to follow, very readable. That's where I got started and I felt like it was great. And also a lot of last year's Coalesce talks are super interesting, very good. A lot of people either demoed or presenting new interesting ways of working DBT or using DBT I really just recommend doing a deep dive of everything that's out there and getting your feet wet.
Totally. I think you're speaking to like the power of community, right? So many folks like yourself are willing to share what they've learned.
Yeah. And
you learned so much in your specific context. Sorry, cut you off.
No, sorry. Last thing I was going to say is join the Slack. Slack is great and you can search on it. And so if you can think of a question, somebody's probably already asked it. It's all a matter of being able to tailor your query in the Slack chat to find what you need.